My mom lay in the ICU ward of the hospital after contracting meningitis. Things weren't looking good, but I remembered a verse in the Bible that gave me hope. I'll share that verse with you next, along with what happened on this episode of Better Life Today. Hello and welcome to this episode of Better Life Today. We're doing another Stories of Faith program, and with me as always is Sayuri Rodriguez. Welcome, Sayuri.
Thank you.
We enjoy doing these programs.
We do.
This is program number 41.
Number 41.
41. Mm-hmm. The Lord has done so many things that we keep on having to do program after program.
That's
after
right.
Program. Yeah. Today is a special topic though. We're going to take on the topic of anointing. Mm-hmm. And some people may not know what that means, but we'll explain in just a moment. Sayuri, why is it that our church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, has such an interest in health?
In health?
Yeah, we've got a lot of hospitals. We've got, we talk a lot about health on this network.
Well, if you think about the story of Jesus and when Jesus was here, a big part of his ministry was healing. And health is so important. Even in the beginning of the Bible, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and you see healthy surroundings and a healthy couple, and I think that's what he desires for us.
Yes. And you know, as I look at the human body, how God made us, it helps build my faith.
Yes.
For me, reading a science book sometimes is almost as good as going to church because you get to see how God works. I just saw a video about DNA recently, and I wanted to bring some DNA facts to the audience to see how wonderful God is. Wait till you hear this. DNA, of course, is the code used to build life. Mm-hmm. That's God's code. It's very similar to the computer code. It's very advanced. There are four molecules used in that code, just like we have letters, 26 letters, I haven't counted them recently. Just like our alphabet, though, there is a code, and it's four letters, A, C, G, and T. That's what the scientists have assigned them. Mm-hmm. And inside most all of our cells, if not all of our cells, is a copy of the code that was used to make us, every cell. Mm-hmm. Do you know how small that is?
How small?
It's just, it's very small. But in that code, it's a long code inside every cell. And if you said three letters every second, and you went through the whole code that's in one of your cells, three letters every second, it would take you 31 years
wow.
to say all the code inside one of your cells.
Wow.
It's that long. Uh-huh. It's that complex. And God was able to put the instructions for making you and making me in a space that's just so small. And science has not figured out how in the world that code could have been encoded. You know, for a computer code, you need a computer programmer. Mm-hmm. And they don't know how. You know, they want to say evolution did it, they want to say chance did it, but you can't show it. There's no proof. They'd have no proof that your cells by themselves can be encoded with information like that. But we know there is a master.
Exactly.
Programmer.
Only God.
And God did it. So it helps to build our faith. Now, we want to talk about anointing, but there is a text that goes along with that. Would you share our text for the day?
Sure. Yeah. The Bible verse is found in the book of James, chapter 5, verse 14 and 15. And it says, "Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven." Isn't that, precious?
That is a precious text, and it helped to give me hope in the story that I'm going to share in a few minutes.
Okay.
But first of all, it used a word in that text, anointing.
Yes.
What is anointing, Sayuri?
Well, I was trying to figure out what was the best way of explaining this, and I told my husband, and he said, you know, anointing is being set aside to do God's will, to accept God's will.
Yeah. And the mechanics of it were that somebody would come and they would put oil mm-hmm. on your forehead. Like in our case, we put oil on the forehead, and we call that anointing. Mm-hmm. What does the oil symbolize?
Represent? Yeah. The Holy Spirit.
Yes. So what we're saying is we are turning that person's life over to God.
Amen.
Asking for the power of the Holy Spirit
right.
to come into their life mm-hmm. to do His will. Now, we hope that will is healing.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's not. But to give your life totally over to God is the most important thing.
Right.
Because
exactly.
healing will come either now
or exactly.
or
I
in
like
the
that.
Future. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we say, okay, the Lord has let the person pass under the sleep of death.
Mm-hmm.
But the next thing that person knows in the resurrection, they'll have a new body. They'll have a forever to look forward to mm-hmm. with God in a perfect place because they have given their lives to God. They've consecrated themselves to God. But sometimes when anointing happens, we do see miraculous turn of events.
Yeah. We do.
So we wanted to talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
Saidi, let's start with a short story you had about your shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
What happened?
I've been having problems with my shoulder for some time, and uh-huh. I had been sharing with you and our coworkers. And there was a big trip that was coming up when we went to Australia. And you know, there's hours and hours to be on the plane, and the pain, I had it constantly. Mm. And so I was dreading, I mean, I wanted to go to Australia, but I was dreading the trip, the plane trip. Just because I thought, oh, I'm going to be in pain the whole time. And thinking of, you know, an ice pack and just thinking of different ideas. And my husband said, well, we need to pray about this. You know, we need to pray specifically for this. We started praying specifically for that pain. And it was to the point that, you know, the whole church was praying for my pain. You know, during prayer meeting, praying. You know, when you go through it and you see it happening where you go, no pain. It's been an hour,
yeah.
2 hours, no pain. When before is constant, you see the hand of God moving. And the whole trip, no pain at all.
Wow.
Now, of course, once I got there, then I started having a little bit of pain. Put some ice, mm-hmm. the rest of the time was wonderful. Coming back, no pain at all.
Wow.
It was amazing to see that this was not something that I was doing on my own.
Mm-hmm.
Or anybody else. This was just the hand of God protecting and giving me a pain-free trip to Australia.
So in this case, you weren't anointed per se, but the church came together.
During prayer meeting, and my husband, and we were just praying.
So the Lord answers prayers.
He does.
Yeah.
He does.
Now, sometimes we choose for anointing.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to tell you a
yes.
story of what that happened for me.
Mm-hmm.
A number of years ago, when my mom got sick one day, and she is a widow, so she was living alone at home. And so I called her up, and she said she didn't sound good. So I went over to see her on the way to work, and it looked like the flu. I said, oh, looks like you got a bad flu or something. I'll check in on you at lunch. So at lunchtime, I came by and checked on her, and she was still looking not that great.
Mm.
I said, it's got to be the flu. Early in the afternoon, I think it was, I got a call from my brother, and he said, Mom's doesn't sound good. You need to check on her, or something like that.
Okay.
And I just felt impressed to race over there. I raced right over there, and she looked bad. I said, what am I going to do? And, you know, thoughts are racing. Okay,
right.
Urgent care, try to get into the doctor. Do I take her to the emergency room? All of these thoughts came in. I finally decided that I'm not going to risk it. We're going to go right to the emergency room.
Good.
So I went in, and they apparently saw that she didn't look good. They put her right into the
wow.
hospital. And I was like, wow. And so I went home, and here it was evening now. I went home. And I got a call, and they said, you need to come back. Well, apparently there was some kind of event that happened with her. And I think when I came back, all of a sudden she's in ICU.
Wow.
And I'm like, how'd this happen? She mm-hmm. looked like the flu in the morning, and now
right.
by night she's in ICU.
Hmm.
Doctors started talking about, okay, does she have an agreement? Does she have a form filled out about what to do if she, you know, is in a serious situation? Do we want to resuscitate her and all this? I was like, why are we talking like
wow.
this? So it made me nervous. That is kind of standard for them to
mm-hmm.
ask those questions. But
you were not expecting that.
I wasn't expecting it. Well, she was in the hospital for a while. And the next day or two, I forget how long it took, I was with her in the hospital when the nurse walked in and said, here, put this on. And she gave me a face mask. I said, what's going on? She goes, well, the test came back. Your mom has meningitis.
Oh, wow.
Now, I don't know if the audience knows, but meningitis is a serious
mm-hmm.
illness. You'll hear young people getting it
yeah,
and they pass away.
They do.
Or I think in colleges it comes
yes.
out. and you can have you can lose limbs mm-hmm. by the time you get out of the
Very
hospital
sad.
With meningitis. And so they asked me, you know, were you around her? And they wanted me to take antibiotic and all this kind of stuff. So all of a sudden I was like, how did she get meningitis? They said, we don't know how this happens. People just get it. Okay. Well, she started to look like she was getting better, and they moved her to another floor.
Okay.
Then she had a big relapse. Mm. Went back to ICU. It looked bad. I went in there, and a specialist came in. When you have these diseases like that, you've got public health people. A lady came in, I think. A specialist, the hospital specialist, came in and looked at her. And he looked at me, and he said, oh, this is going to be a long road. And I didn't know what that meant. I didn't want to know what that meant. You know, by the time we had reached that point, I think we were tired. Mm-hmm. I think it was later into the week. I forget how long it was. But by that time, I was like, oh, I didn't necessarily want to hear that.
Yeah.
But you know what? There was a verse, the verse we just read.
Uh-huh.
And I said, we need to call the elders. So I called the pastor. I said, Pastor, could you please come and anoint my mom
mm-hmm.
and bring the elders?
Mm-hmm.
And a time and a place was set. And I said, let's meet in the hospital chapel first. So we came together, we gathered in the hospital chapel, and I gathered with the other gentleman.
Was that your idea?
In our church? Yeah, I wanted to meet with them in the chapel for a reason. I'll explain it in a second. So the elders came in, and elders in our church are some of the leaders of the church.
Right.
And we came into the chapel, and I said, you know, before we go anoint my mom, I said, it's important to me. I said, could we please do a couple things first? I said, first, let's spend some time and make sure that all of our sins are confessed
mm-hmm.
so that we come before the Lord without the stain of sin upon us. You know, we make sure that we are right with God.
Right.
I said, would we all do that? And, you know, so we all took time and we were talking to the Lord. And then I said, there's something else that's important to me. I said, before we go see my mom, I said, would you, let's tell stories about what the Lord has done for us in the past, either for us or maybe a relative or friend.
Mm-hmm.
I said, let's build up our faith by talking
Amen.
About how great God is,
Amen.
And how powerful God is.
I
and
love
we
that
went
part.
Around. Yeah, you like that?
That's my favorite part of the story.
We went around sharing this part.
Amen.
And by the time we were done, we were on cloud nine.
Yes.
We were just up there like, oh, God is so great.
Mm-hmm.
God can
That's
do
what
this.
Happens. Yeah.
So we encouraged one another.
Mm-hmm.
Then we went in to the ICU. So imagine the ICU, we'll go through the door and here's a number of us coming in. There was probably, I don't know, five or six of us.
Wow.
And normally they limit the members, the people in there. But I said, I think I got clearance beforehand. I said, no, we're just going to do an anointing.
Okay.
They said, okay, go in. So we all were able to gather around my mom. Now, she was barely
conscious.
She was in and out. I mean, she, you know, but she did not look good.
Okay.
And I'm not sure how much consciousness she has. Later, I asked her. She said she remembers that we were there. And she remembers saying thank you as they were leaving. But I don't know if she remembered much of it.
Mm-hmm.
We had special prayer. The pastor anointed her with oil. And, you know, we were feeling so high at that
yes.
moment. It was like, oh, God will heal her instantly.
Yes.
And so I was kind of looking to wait. You know. But she was just restful, and so we left. The next morning comes along, and I come back into the room, and every morning we waited for the doctor to give the report.
Okay.
So my brother and I were both there waiting for the doctor. But we need to take a break right now.
Oh.
So if you want to hear the rest of the story, you're going to have to stay tuned. We'll be right back after this message. Hello and welcome back to Better Life Today. We're telling stories of faith today. And I was right in the middle of telling the story of my mom who was in the hospital with meningitis. So Saidi, I was sharing about how the pastor had anointed her that night. We all went home. The next morning happened. My brother and I are there. We're waiting for the doctor to come in to give the report. Mom's laying there. I decide I'm going to slip out. Take a restroom break right then. I do. When I come back, the doctor has come into the room.
Uh-huh.
I pull aside the curtain, and there is my mom sitting up in bed talking to the doctor.
Oh.
This was kind of unusual. This is kind of unexpected.
You hadn't seen her?
No, right? She hadn't been in that good of condition. I listened, and she was kind of, imagine somebody who's coming out of a deep sleep.
Uh-huh.
You might not be 100%
okay.
there, but you're there. And so they were talking about, I think she was talking about her, she used to be a nurse or something.
Oh.
And I said, well, what's happening here? And mom's condition at that moment, after the anointing, the next day, took a turn for the
wow.
better. She just started to improve at that point on.
Praise God.
Now, to tell you that this, you know, it wasn't just my perception. Later that day, she was sleeping again. And the specialist that I told you about came back in, the one who said this is going to be a long road.
Mm-hmm.
He came back in and he walked in and he said, I hear there's been a change. I think at the time I mentioned, yeah, we anointed her last
uh-huh.
night. I think I said that. I can't remember. And then he said, I hear there's been a change for the better. And I said, I said, yes. So he went over to try to talk to her, but she was sleeping at the time, you know. So I said, and she's a little hard of hearing. I said, I need to help. So I got up and I went over to Mom and I got close. I said, Mom, the doctor's here. He wants to talk to you. You know, her eyes pop open and the doctor begins his little thing. Move your right hand, move your left hand, move your left foot, right foot, that kind of a thing. And after seeing what she could do and that she was alert again, he said, her change is remarkable.
Wow, praise the Lord.
And I said, I knew the Lord was working.
Yeah.
And from that point on out, she made steady improvement until she was released from the hospital. When she was released from the hospital, the doctor told her, you're a lucky woman. Now, I'm thinking to myself, no, she's blessed.
Mm-hmm.
She's not lucky, she's blessed.
She's blessed.
The doctor said, you're a lucky woman. She says, when people get meningitis, when they leave the hospital, they can easily be missing an arm or a part of their arm, I should say, or a part of their leg or something. She said, but my mom, when she left the hospital, and by the time she continued and finished her healing, she pretty much was exactly where she was before she went in the hospital, as far as her physical condition.
Praise the Lord.
So I feel that the Lord came down and touched her that night and said, I will grant your prayer.
Healing, by the way. Praise God.
So for me, anointing has a special place in my heart.
Yeah. Yes, that's beautiful. Well, I have a story of a friend of ours, and she shared this with us, and it was a beautiful story. She said that one day, years ago, she was traveling with her family on a car, and in front of her was a big school bus because they were teachers. So the teachers and the students were in the bus, but she was in the car with her husband and her little ones. They were little, three of them.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden, it was very late at night. They had been having problems with the cars, and so now they were gonna arrive to the school really late at night. And it was just so dark, and it had been a long, long trip. The husband started falling asleep.
Oh, no.
To the point that their car just turned and just went down a hill. And when she remembers opening her eyes, she kept screaming, my children, where are my children? One of them, the boy, was in the back. But the other two, the two little girls, a toddler and a baby, she couldn't see them. And so the dad was able to get out of the car because the car had turned completely. Mm. He got out of the car looking for the kids. And he said that he saw someone like with a light going like this.
Mm.
He couldn't see the face, just the light. So he started running towards that place. And that's where he found his toddler first.
Oh.
And then he realized that the person or, you know, the light was also pointing at someplace else, and he went to look for the baby. You know that the baby is almost like somebody just brought her and placed her someplace safe. No scratch, no nothing, baby was safe, yes.
Wow.
They never found out who that person pointing to here they are was, you know?
It had to be an angel.
An angel, amen. Well, they are able to remove her from the car. She was the one that got hurt the most.
The mom,
yes. But she was so concerned for her kids that she was like, don't pay attention to me, just make sure that the kids are okay. Well, she goes to the hospital, she's there for some time, and she's recovering. And people are thinking, it's just scratches, you know, and she's gonna be okay. A year goes by, and she starts feeling very sick, very sick, very weak, just no strength at all, and very dizzy, and she would see, you know, how lights, and you kind of feel like you're fainting. And it just got worse and worse. So she went to the doctor and said, this is what's happening. All tests were done. And they came back and said, I'm so sorry, but you have a very serious disease. And they said, you're going to lose your arm.
Mm.
You're going to lose, you know, the ability to use your arms. And eventually, you're going to lose also the ability to move your legs. You're going to be in a wheelchair for the rest of your life. And she was just devastated by that, thinking, God, you saved me from the, you saved all of us from the accident. Why now? My kids are still little. What am I going to do? I'm not even going to be able to carry them. And they're so small. So she started praying and being sad. She said she was just depressed, thinking, you know, this is going to happen. And one day her husband, who is a pastor, he said to her, honey, why don't we anoint you? Now, there's a thinking, and many times it's in some of our countries, and I think maybe even here, where you think that being anointed is only when you're going to die.
Oh, yeah.
So you get scared. You're like, why am I dying, you know? And so she was very hesitant, like, no, I'm still able to move my arms, you know, I'm not dying. But the husband started explaining to her, but you know, this is a serious disease. You should be anointed. Pray about it.
Mm-hmm.
She prays about it.
Mm-hmm.
And now she's praying about it. She needs to make a decision. And she has an appointment date where they were going to do an MRI
mm-hmm.
to check and, you know, all the things. And she decides, yes, I need to be anointed. The elders come, the pastor comes, and they anoint her. And she said that the moment that they put the oil on her, she felt a peace like she had not experienced.
Uh-huh.
And she started praising God. And she went to the MRI, and her husband was very nervous. Okay, what's going to happen? And she was like, it's going to be okay, you know? She went into the tube where they put you,
mm-hmm.
and she was there, and she said, first she started feeling like a sensation on her toe,
mm-hmm.
and it just went straight to her head. She said, from toe to head,
wow.
like if they shock you,
uh-huh.
tongue, like that, which I recently went through an MRI. You don't feel that.
Yeah.
But she felt that, and she said that when she felt that, she thought to herself, I have been healed.
Oh.
After the anointing the night before, I've been healed. So she came outside, and the husband was like, how did it go? And really nervous, and she was like, I'm fine. I've been healed. And he was like,
what
do you mean you've been healed, you know?
She felt that confident. I've been healed.
Now, the MRI back in Mexico, what they do, I guess they send you the results, and then you take the results to the doctor, something like that. But she said that she didn't want to open the envelope. And the husband was like, maybe you should open the envelope before we get there. Maybe thinking, that way I can comfort you now. I don't know what he was thinking. And she said, no, I already know what's in there. I've been healed. And so they go to the hospital after a week.
Mm-hmm.
They get there. The doctor's there. And he has all the images right there on a screen. And he had this chair, you know, the ones with the rolling...
Oh, the rollers on the bottom?
Rollers on the bottom.
Uh-huh.
So he would move from one side to the other looking at the pictures. And he would look at her. And he would look at them and going back and forth and back and forth until the point that he came and he said, lady, do you believe in God or what's going on? And she said, I believe in God. I've been healed, haven't I? And he was like, I don't understand. He even called a meeting with specialists
mm-hmm.
to talk about what is going to be the treatment for this poor woman because she's dying.
Oh, wow.
And he said, I can't wait to tell them what God has done. I mean, if you're talking about this God, mm-hmm. because there's nothing. You are fine.
Oh.
We can't find anything. Now, she had brought with her a Steps to Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, well, doctor, I just want to let you know that the God that healed me is the same God written in this book. This is for you. And he took the book. And she left that place praising God. The husband was just like, wow, you knew ahead of time. She said, yeah. She was confident that God had answered that prayer, that anointing, with a yes, I will heal you now.
That is a beautiful story.
Yeah.
And you know that book, Steps to Christ, is the one that we offer here.
Yes, that's right.
So I can't let this opportunity pass.
Please.
I want to, audience, if you want to read the book,
it's
Steps
beautiful.
To Christ, we would be happy to send you a free copy within the United States. And if you're outside, contact us. We can get you a digital copy, maybe. Mm-hmm. But we want to get you a copy of the book, Steps to Christ. Just give us a call at the station, and we'll be happy to fulfill that order.
Amen.
We want people to read that book. That's a wonderful book about how you become closer mm-hmm. to Jesus.
It just has a picture of Jesus like you've never experienced before. Beautiful. Mm-hmm.
Well, Sayuri, I'm going to ask you a question. We love it when God says yes, but why does sometimes God say no, do you imagine? I mean, we'll be able to ask him someday in heaven, but even now we have to live with sometimes when God says no.
Right,
Do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, you know, the thought that comes to my mind is there are times that God is going to say no. And in saying no, instead of why and trying to find the reason, I think that's an opportunity, as hard as it seems, to put our faith and to say, you know, do you remember what Jesus said? Your will be done. Not my will, but your will be done.
Yeah.
To the point that you go, I really don't understand, but he knows.
Yeah.
He knows what's best.
Jesus did not want to go to the cross. He didn't want to face that punishment for us.
Mm-hmm.
As the human side of him, like us, would say, no, I don't, that's a terrible thing to go through. But he submitted his will to the Lord and said, Lord, not my will, I don't want to do it, but not my will, your will be done. And that was an example for us.
Exactly.
So when we come to the Lord and say, Lord, I want to be healed, but I wasn't. Okay, not my will, but your will be done.
I heard a story of a man who had a wife that was very, very sick. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he was praying. She was anointed. And she died. And he kept asking, why did you let this happen? Why? And just all these questions. You could have done it like that. You know, you could have done this. I've seen you done this, that, and question after question. And there was one day that he decided, you know, I've been spending all this time asking myself why. Mm-hmm. It's time to give it to the Lord. And just to accept, you know, this is what happened. He knows best. And he wrote something really beautiful that I always think about, because he said, you know, there will be a day that all of our question marks mm-hmm. are going to become exclamation points, saying, this was the reason. Praise God. Hallelujah.
So I don't know now, but I will know someday.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, there was another story we told in a previous program about a lady who had an eye problem. I think she even went blind from it. Mm-hmm. She called for the anointing from her church pastor and elders. They came and they anointed her, and her eye was healed. The doctor told her, there's nothing more we can do for you. Her eye was healed.
I remember that. Yeah.
A little bit later on, the other eye.
Right.
And so she calls the pastor. Let's call the pastor and elders again. And they pray over and anoint her about the second eye.
Uh-huh.
But it doesn't heal.
It didn't heal. I remember.
And the pastor, nobody knows why. Same pastor, same elders. Uh-huh. Why didn't it heal? And she said, one day she came to the pastor and said, Pastor, I know why. And he goes, well, tell me why. She said, the first time God healed me because he wanted to know, would I trust that he would heal me? The second time he didn't heal me, he wanted me to trust him,
even
if I didn't heal, even if God didn't heal her.
Wow.
She said, and so I'm okay. And she was okay with it.
Amen.
She was at peace with that. She gave her heart to, she gave her life to the Lord.
Yeah.
Well, friends, that brings us to the end of another program. We hope you've been blessed. We talked about the service of anointing, and hopefully your church has it.
Mm-hmm.
If you have more questions, give us a call. We'll be happy to share that with you. But for now, we'll just leave it that the Lord is good and does wonderful works, and we can trust him. Join us next time.